In this session, we will learn elements of modeling. This part of the analysis where, just like we did an exercise for understanding the inventory control system, what kind of information that fellow requires, how that information will be represented, we looked at that, right? We are now looking at a formal mechanism of modeling information system needs. This formal mechanism is called ER model or entity relationship model. Before looking at the information modeling, I thought we'll quickly look at a familiar example from the academic information system. Remember I said course list information management? You are all familiar with the course list. As I said, you all submit individual registrations and you have to prepare a list of all students who are taking my course, who are taking Professor Sudarshan's course, etc., etc. That transformation, I said, is non-trivial, and we'll look at some of the plot. Then we'll go over to information modeling and study the elements of entity relationship model. Here is the first assignment. This is not to be submitted. This is an assignment to be discussed here. Let's call it assignment zero. Let's say we have 4,500 students, about 5,000 now. Each student registers for an average of 6 courses. Agreed? So you fill up a form in which you list all the 6 courses on an average, some 3, some 5, some 7, whatever. Submit that registration form. Assume that's the system that exists. The academic office has collected all 4,500 forms. And they transcribe these 4,500 forms in some way into computer records. But now the academic office is required to produce a course list for each of the courses that is offered. Assume that we want to print a course list for CS634. Assume that there are 300 courses running. What is the logic that you will design for the algorithm which from this input data, 4,500 forms, each containing on an average 6 course codes. From this, how will you prepare 300 course lists, each containing anywhere between 5 to 300 students for each course? That's the problem. This is a typical inversion problem. It's not easy as it appears. The assumption is each form has fixed and variable information. So roll number, name, degree, branch is fixed information. The variable information is the registration data, which is course, not course, comma code, but course code, course name, credit, slot, etc. And assume that all the forms are stored in a computer file, let's say. How will you produce this? So any idea how will you produce a course list? You have a computer file. Each record is a form. The form has a part which is a fixed part, giving your roll number, name, etc., etc. And a variable part which says n courses. The value of n itself is entered there. Let's say 3, 4, 5, whatever courses you register for. And there are entries for those 3 or 4 courses. What is relevant from the point of view of preparing course list is not the credits for the course, slot, whatever. Just the course code and your roll number. So if the course code occurs in your registration form, your roll number should appear in the course list for that course code. There are likely to be hundreds of other students who have the same course code. All those 100 should appear in the list for that course. How do you get this 4,500 forms data in a file and prepare a 300 form sort of the list to be output? How will you do that? Any idea? Appears to be a simple algorithm, right? Suppose you had a file of 4,500 forms, physical file. All these 4,500 forms are there. And you are told to prepare a course list for all the courses. How will you go about it manually? Don't forget that till recently, IIT Bombay, the course lists were produced manually. Not very recently, but 20 years ago. And even today in many institutions, such course lists are still produced by hand. Now you are definitely superior in intelligence and wisdom to a clerk. So if a clerk can do that, you should be able to do that. So here is a quick recap of roughly what we all agreed. Read the file one record at a time. If any of the courses matches CS634, print the roll number and name. That was the first solution for CS634. In a single scan of the file, the course list for CS634 is produced. You have read 4,500 records. However, the entire registration data for all students will have to be processed, whether or not somebody has registered for that course. So run the previous algorithm 300 times once for each course. That is what roughly amounted to. The file will be read 300 times. How costly is this operation time-wise? Okay, that's one question. You can do the other way around. Okay, you can keep these 300 one by one, you can take the course and read 4,500, whatever. Okay. Alternately, read the file once, storing all the data. So each record is 80 bytes, 4,500 students, this many bytes. All of you are familiar that the modern computers have much more memory than this. So you can avoid making computer read and write data from files by reading all of it into the computer memory and compile lists for all courses in memory. Assume even 500 students per course. Okay, you can still have enough memory allocated to each course as an array and you can prepare that. And that brings us to the very fundamental aspect of programming for processing information. And that is, you can never assume that all of the data will fit in the memory. Never. You can only assume that one record at a time or typically a few records can sit inside memory. But otherwise the data file will reside on the disk. So this is a better approach. First, prepare a file of records with following structure. Roll number, 8 characters, course code, 6 characters. This is very interesting. Let's get back here to see this. Here you got the file which we call the registration file, in which, as we said, we have a student with roll number R1 and he has registered, let's say, for C1, C2, C3. Let's take another student, R2, who has registered for C1, C4, C5. Let's say, example. Now what I do is, I read each registration file only, record only once. I prepare a new file. This is a new file. In this new file, I write a special kind of record. I read this. Ah, here is roll number 1. And he has registered for course C1. So I write a file R1, C1. Same student has registered for C2. I write another record where I repeat the roll number, write C2. He has registered for C3. I write R1, C3. His registration record is over. I look at the next fellow, R2. R2 has registered for C1. I write R2, C1. R2 has registered for C4. I write R2, C4. R2, C5. In same way, so I read this data only once, but for every record that I read, I prepare as many smaller records as I require, depending on how many courses that fellow has registered. At the end of a single scan of this file, how many such records I will have likely? 4,500 into approximately 6, because on an average everybody registers for 6. It will not be 4,500 into 300. Right? But still large number of records are there. Now I do a very fancy thing. I sort these records. Notice that this file is sorted on roll number, if my original file was sorted, but it doesn't matter here. But I sort these records on course code and within course code on roll number. The transform file I will get will have R1, C1, but R2, C1, maybe R7, C1, that means all the fellows who have taken course C1 will come in the sorted order first. After all these fellows are finished, C2 will come here, maybe R1 will come, and other fellows will come. So in a single sort action of this file, I would get the data reorganized subject-wise. Now, I read this sorted file only once. I read the first record, C1, R1. I start outputting course list for C1. R1 belongs to C1, output the roll number. R2 belongs to C1, output. R7 belongs to C1, output. Suppose R1 ends, R2 starts. I'll announce course list for C1 is over, course list for C2 is now beginning. That means just as in a single scan of the input file, I could create all the relevant information about course registration. By one sort, I have converted into a position where a single scan of this file can now help me create all the records for all the courses. Do you see this point? Two points I would like to make. I could sort only this, because this information has clearly a sort field identifiable, namely course code field. Here there is no such field, because this is not a single information, there are multiple pieces. What do I sort? Even somebody else who registered for C1 may not write C1 in the first lot, he might write it in the fourth. So there is nothing that I can sort here. I can only sort these records on roll number, which is not useful. So by breaking this information into pieces which are relevant for correlating the student and the course. Please note that every record here gives me an association. This student has registered for this course. This student has registered for this course. This association information I am able to extract, one single sort, which will take much less than multiple scanning of any file, I will get this into. Do you agree that this is a better process? Right. The reason I spend this time is, as you will see in the subsequent discussion, information modeling actually attempts to capture this principle in proper representation of information that you have to handle. Yeah.
So when it's online and I'm feeding the course information right now,
yes,
then won't it make sense to immediately add it to the corresponding course, rather than doing all this later on and again sorting it?
The whole point is, there is nothing like a corresponding course data. There is no roll list maintained ever. That's the whole point. The only thing that you need to ever maintain is this. If you index it on roll number, you can always reconstruct the registration data for that roll number. If you index it on course code, you can always get the data for the course. So the presentation to people from a different perspective is a different aspect. The storage is different task. Our problem is that in our mindset, just as we have a physical registration form and a teacher has a physical course list, we presume that that's the only way in which information must be stored inside the computer. As we shall see in the modeling, that is not necessary at all. Can you not see that if I have separate information which describes the basic student with roll number, name, hostel number, etc. somewhere, and basic information of 300 courses, course, slot, etc., etc., then the only information I require to associate a student with a course is this information. Absolutely nothing else is required to be stored. You agree? Any other information stored will be superfluous if I have the basic information for both the case. Right? Okay. So let's get back to the modeling. This is a better approach, as I mentioned. Prepare a file of records with this form. Read each record of the registration file. For each course code, output one record of the above type. So up to 6 records on an average will be created per student based on the registration. Now sort this file on course code and produce this list by one for the output. This is the standard conventional way of procedural programming. This is now not how it is done in databases. But to see what is done in databases, first it is important to understand how modeling is done in a model. And that is what we shall see. We will ignore this. I already mentioned that business information system, the data is always stored in non-volatile files on some external media. And entire files are always considered too large to fit in memory. Processing is always done record by record. Okay. Reading, writing to media such as disk needs significantly more time than to memory. Okay. And disk I.O. is order of milliseconds, memory read-write is order of nanoseconds. Not one nanosecond, but tens or hundreds of nanoseconds. So thousands of times difference. It is in this context that we look at the information system modeling. Once we identify our functional requirements, what that system is supposed to do, academic office system is supposed to take care of registration. We need to know more details about information needed and how it is represented. What should be the user interface to the information system? To student, you should see a screen where you can enter all the courses. To teacher, I can see all the students for my course, etc., etc. Specifications for processing and control for processing sequence. Okay. The information modeling aspect, which is the crux of analysis, takes care of defining information structure. So which are the entities and what are the attributes that participate in the information system? What is the functional behavior? How does the data flow and how it is processed? And what are the control structures? What events will happen? What actions to be taken at that event? What are the state transitions? You all understand state transition? It's a simple mathematical concept. Entity relationship model which is a classical model of information systems. What currently is used by software professionals are object-oriented paradigms, such as UML or Universal Modeling Language and so on. But this is so fundamental and important and easy to understand, I thought we'll start with this. So first we define an entity. Entity is an object or thing which is relevant to our needs. Part is an entity. Supplier of parts is an entity. Plant is an entity. Transaction is an entity, because entity has some information associated. Okay. Student, teacher, course, department, hostel, these are all entities. Okay. An entity set, or what is in object terminology called object class, is a set of entities of the same type. So all students form an entity set. The set may be named student, but the moment we name a set, it means there are 4,500 students in IIT. Course is an entity. There are 300 courses. Part is an entity. So there may be 10,000 parts. So the entity represents a set, actually. Obviously, each entity has certain attributes. What are the attributes? Characteristic features of any entity in a set. Every entity has many characteristic features. Take a student. What features student has? Student has a name. Student has date of birth. Student also has height, weight. For academic purposes, what are the relevant things? Roll number, name, maybe hostel number, maybe room number. Okay. So at you, from thousands of attributes a student may have, you are going to choose only those attributes which are relevant for that information system. That's the crux of identifying attributes describing an entity in the context of information system. So features that you select must play a role in the business functions. Otherwise, they are meaningless. For part entity, for example, these could be the attributes. Please note I am using abbreviations, which I think can make sense. P number, part number. P name, part name. P location, location in the inventory, which bin. PQTY, quantity at hand. PROP, reorder point. PROQ, reorder quantity. PO date, the part order date for supply. P sub, the supply, etc. For transaction entity, I could say T date, transaction date, T type, transaction type, T ref, some reference number of order, T quantity. Notice that these names are abbreviated merely for human convenience, because we are lazy in writing full names. If you use COBOL programs which permit variable names or attribute names of 31 characters, then you are required to write a part reorder point. In TCS, for example, there was a rule that if you had a variable name which was less than 20 characters long, you lose your job. Why? Because the program that you write should be understood easily by others. The naming, therefore, is an important aspect of the analysis and therefore of the design. This can be considered to be designed. Take student in. Roll number, name, hostel of residence, room number, performance index as we understand it, CPI. In some of the participating colleges, it might be marks obtained. Courses registered, hobbies. Why would hobbies be relevant? They may not be relevant for academic office, but they may be relevant, for example, for a hostel sports secretary to figure out who plays hockey, who plays badminton, who sings well. So, this is another point to note. What may not be relevant from an academic information system perspective may be relevant from another perspective of application in the same environment. So consequently, just as you have an attribute list relevant for academic office, there could be attribute list relevant for sports, attribute list relevant for something else. And the common denominator of all of these must constitute the attributes which are meaningful for an organization. Okay. The entity relationship model attempts to formalize this representation. This permits us to depict information that we need to handle. Entity set is represented by a rectangle, and attributes are represented by ellipses attached to that rectangle. It's a very simple diagrammatic model. So this is an entity model. For example, here is a student entity. You see all these ellipses? S role, S name, S hostel, S room. Why have I added S? To indicate that it is student. Of course, in an academic context, we are only talking about course and student, but in a larger context, we'll say student role, student hostel, whatever one. But this is understandable by most of you, therefore I have kept this here. Notice something else also. Notice that some of these have double ellipses. Notice that one of the attributes has an underline. Underline would probably mean unique. That is very obvious. Roll number. So roll number is unique for every entity in the set. Even if I have 5,000 entities. Why can't I choose S name? There could be two people with the same name. I can't choose hostel. Because in a single hostel, there will be many students. Suppose hypothetically, because that condition does not obtain in the hostels here, but maybe in some of the participating hostels it may be true, that we guarantee that every student will be accommodated in a room. There will be no two students given the same room. Then, hypothetically, cannot the combination of hostel and room be unique? But what could be the meaning of the double ellipses? Why is it, how is it different from the single ellipse? Yes, as all of you are murmuring, these are multiple values. S courses means a fellow may register for on an average 6 or 10 courses. Similarly, a student might have 10 hobbies or 2 hobbies. In general, this represents an attribute which could have multiple values. But this represents an attribute which will have only exactly one value. A student will have one name, one hostel, one room, not one CPI. The CPI will change, but at any given point in time, the student will have only one. So that is why these are single ellipses. This is how I would represent this entity set in a table. You agree that is a very simple, straightforward translation? Let's go back to this. Student, S role, S name, S hostel, S room, etc. S role, S name, S hostel, etc. What you see on the top are attribute names. Notice that this is metadata. This is actual data. 7801102 is the actual roll number value. But S roll, and please remember that S roll on its own does not signify complete information about metadata. We know that it is roll number. But whether it should be only digits, it should be characters, nothing is specified so far. So the model only pictorially permits you to depict what is the entity and what are the associated attributes. Much more needs to be done to describe this analysis properly. However, you can see that if I have such an entity model, to actually represent the data in a table is straightforward. I write all the attribute names as column headers, and one row per student, I will have 4,500 rows. Consequently, 4,500 records in a file is the direct file representation in a data file for the entity set called student. That's very easy to understand. Of course, there is a problem. How do I represent some of these attributes subsequent? For example, the multiple valued attributes. But let's consider this, course. You will agree that course is identified by course code, course name, course credits, course students, course faculty, maybe course slot, etc. You will also agree that course code is another artificial creation of mine to give uniqueness to code. You will also agree that number of students registered for the course, number of faculty members teaching the course could be multiple people. But you will also agree that converting this into a table form is straightforward. And consequently, the table form into something else is also in a computer file is also straightforward. So consequently, I could have a file or database table which contains information about course codes. So there will be 300 odd entries there, and there could be 4,500 entries for students, and that will create and maintain all proper information about students and courses, barring, of course, these multiple kind of things. Here is a problem. Continuing further, the table representation may have the C code, some other information, and C faculty. Assume CS634 is being taught by Deepak Phatak and Umesh Belur. Now there are two people here. Same problem that we will face, that we were facing while representing the form of registration. Notice that the registration form as presented to us as a user interface is one thing. But storing this information inside a digitized file is a different thing. Can I ever sort this on faculty? If I sort this on faculty, Deepak Phatak will come at D, but Umesh Belur will not come at any specific place here. This is where we need to look at attributes in some more details. Now, this is something that is not necessarily very obvious. So let's quickly go through the types of attribute that we may have to encounter, we may encounter in life. Single valued attributes is very straightforward. You all know. An attribute which will only have a single value at any time. Roll number, name, hostel, etc. Derived attributes is another type of attribute. We shall see what derived attribute. Composite attribute is third type of attribute. Attributes with null values is another classification of attributes. And multi-valued attributes for which we saw those double ellipses. So far, you have seen and understood intuitively what is a single valued attribute and what is a multi-valued attribute. We'll see how to handle multi-valued attributes, but let's quickly look at other types of attribute also because we do encounter them while modeling. Single valued attributes, as I said, is very simple and straightforward. Roll number of a student, course name, date of birth of a person, capacity of a lecture hall, price of sugar at a shop. These are single values. Common sense, no discussion required. Derived attributes. An attribute whose value is derived from other independently defined attributes. For example, age of a person. Suppose in the student entity, I had associated an attribute called age. It is valid, it is relevant. I want to know how old is my student. The trouble is that if I enter age, say 18, now that 18 is valid at most for a duration of 1 year. It might be 18 on the day I capture that information. Tomorrow it may change. So the sanctity and longevity of that piece of information is guaranteed to be lost sooner rather than later. And that is why it is not considered correct to choose a derived value as an attribute. It is better to store date of birth from which age at any date can be derived any time. Okay. Total salary of an employee is another attribute. It's an important attribute. After all, that is the salary I get, so I would like to know that. But because it consists of a sum of basic pay allowances minus deductions, better to store separate attribute values and calculate the sum, because if some allowance changes, some deduction changes, then I should be able to calculate the sum correctly at any point. So you understand derived attributes now, and you understand that it is not a good idea unless there are compelling reasons to store the derived. In no formal database, the derived attribute alone will ever be stored and represented. Even if it is required for speed of calculation, for example, because you don't want to spend every time calculate the total or something, you will always store the independent attributes. And additionally, you may store the derived attribute knowing fully well that this derived attribute may not be consistent at all times. If something else changes, the derived attribute must also change. Composite attribute. Consider Ramesh Vadwani, who is going to give a big donation. We just negotiated for our bio school. And I want to store his address. How would his address look like? First, there will be a street in which there will be a house number and street name. Then there will be city, then there will be a state or postal index number, and then country. The Americans call this PIN as zip. So I will have to also identify in metadata somewhere that why I call it PIN, it is zip for US, whatever. And then future planet and solar system if a future donor comes from Mars, for example. So all of these together constitute the address. Address itself appears as just one attribute of the donor entity. So donor has name, donor has amount of donation given, and donor has address. But the address in turn consists of so many things. Now there will be occasions when I would like to print the entire address and forget about it. There will be occasions when I would like to identify individual components of that address. For example, I want to find out how many donors from Bangalore do I have. I would like to sort the data on city. And the city would be lost if my representation of the attribute is only address. Again, in case of composite attribute, it is better to put individual components as attributes and define some kind of conglomeration attribute for the purposes of handling the composite entity called address. That is also clear. Null valued attribute. What if value of an attribute is either not known? For example, CPI was an attribute. When you join the institute, what is your CPI during the month of September? Is it zero? No, it's not zero certainly. It's not known. Will it be all right to represent that unknown quantity by zero? Imagine your parents getting a report card saying zero CPI before you even give exams. Not acceptable to you. It is not known. I will have to find a mechanism to say that I don't know this value at this particular. There is no known mechanism. In conventional programming, when you want to represent data slated as null, you use very funny kind of internal representation. For example, at one time people used to put -1 for salary to imply that it is null. Because obviously nobody can have -1 salary. If name is not known, they will put ************************************************************************************************************************************************************************************************************************************************************************************************************************************************************************************************
problem. But then you have to write logic in your program to handle that null value. If value is star, 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 sorry, I don't know the name, something. There has to be a different mechanism. For numerical attribute values, you can't even guarantee that an artificial value like minus 1 you have said may not happen to be a correct value somewhere. 0 is certainly not acceptable. So there has to be a special way of handling null attribute anywhere in information system. Not known could be one reason, not applicable could be another reason. For example, number of children is the attribute of the employee. There is also an attribute, marital status. Now, at least in India, I don't know about the Western world, but in India, if an employee is unmarried and you ask him to fill in the number of children, he would hesitate to write even 0. He will say, what nonsense, this question is not applicable to me. Isn't it? So, when it is not applicable again, you have to put a null value. You can't put 0 there. So, there are situations like this where you have to handle null valued attributes and you better provide for them. What is the impact of null values in numerical calculations? Let's take these are roll numbers and these are marks obtained in an examination. There are 5 students and 5 marks. If I did not have a mechanism to represent null value here, let's say these students did not appear for exam, I would probably put 0 here. If I did put 0, a dumbo program could read these marks to calculate the average and divide the sum by 5. Will that be correct average? So obviously, in calculation of cumulative values such as averages, I must not count these at all. Neither add 0, nor count these for division. You understand the important implication? And preferably, this should happen automatically. I should not have to write a program to say, oh, this was the artificial null value, so I should ignore it. Because that will mean additional godagiri for me to write the program and for machine to do the additional work. Null should not be counted if possible. You all agree, therefore, that there has to be a special representation of null possible in information processing applications. Such is not the requirement for computational application that you usually write. Although if you look at sparse matrices, if some of you have handled them, where the actual data is only in few rows and columns, others are null actually, it is not 0, okay, it is null. Okay. Let's look at multi-valued attributes. Number of courses taken by a student, number of teachers teaching a course, number of hobbies of a student. The problems we face is each of these becomes a list of values. Number of courses taken by a student is a list, 6 courses. The problem is identity of an individual element of the list is blurred to the external interface. I can't sort, I can't extract information quickly, I can't index. Only single valued items I can index on or sort on. So this is a pain. And therefore, this has to be modeled differently and special. Okay. So how do we handle this model? We have seen already that in multi-valued attribute, how do you find all courses taught by Umesh Bellur? Let's imagine that you entered this data, C faculty, multi-valued attributes. Deepak Phatak, Umesh Bellur. Here is Umesh Bellur. If you sort this list on faculty, you will get D first, then probably K, then S, and then U. But if you read only this, you will get Umesh Bellur only teaching this. The fact that he is also teaching CS364 is lost. You can imagine what would happen if you sorted the registration forms on the course list. The sorting will be only on the first course that anybody has mentioned. It is not of any consequence to us. Consequently, multi-valued attributes are considered impossible to handle and therefore never factored into any modeling. Now that is something which is not common sense. But because you understand the implications, which are not good for processing of that information, you will appreciate that if we take a bold stand, no matter what, I will never represent an attribute which is multi-valued in my model. All my attributes will be single-valued. If that is so, then can I still represent useful information? After all, we have seen both the entities that we studied have actual multi-valued attributes. The entity model ensures that each entity in that set can be uniquely identified. You already seen the purpose, roll number, course code. This is very clear. This particular thing is called a primary key. Each entity must have a primary key, and you typically show it by underlining. A key is a set of attributes, and that set of attributes must have unique values amongst the entities of that set. The second point we make in the model is avoid multi-valued attributes for the reasons that we just elucidated. We'll quickly see the notion of primary key in some details. Later on, when we study databases formally and modeling more formally, we'll see that there is something called super key, there's something called candidate key, etc., etc. We'll discuss those things later. But primary key is a simple concept, all of you appreciate. And we'll see how we avoid multi-valued attributes. What are the primary key choices? We already discussed this. Suppose hostel and room was unique for a person. We did say S hostel and S room as a combination can be a primary key. And of course, there are problems with such a choice as have already been pointed out. That somebody may change the hostel or room during the stay here itself. And that there can't be uniqueness for a long period of 10, 15 years because somebody else will occupy that hostel. The point that I'm trying to make is that in this case, wise, it is not correct to choose this, but it is possible to have a unique key which is not a single attribute but a combination of attributes. In such case, in our model, we depict it by underlining all the attributes which form such a composite primary key. So if in my model I had written S role just like that, S name just like that, S hostel and S room as underlined, then it is understood that S hostel plus S room together form a primary key. Of course, it is not very material for our making a choice here for the reasons that we already discussed and maintained here. But the table representation is very simple. Now we are saying each table has a primary key. We are saying it has no repeated, no multiple valued attributes, multi-valued attributes. So column headers become the metadata, which are attribute names. We need to specify more for the metadata, as I just mentioned. S role or S name or S hostel does not tell me everything. So for every attribute, I must also record in my modeling in plain English language, along with that diagram, I must say that the value is integer or string. For example, S hostel in IIT Bombay is a two-digit number. But not all two digits are permitted. So permissible range of values between 0, 1 and 13. Otherwise, some idiot will enter 28 as hostel number. Why this specification is required? Because when you write programs, somebody has to ensure to validate that data against these specifications so that no garbage ever enters our system. But there are problems. What about a project staff come student who stays in Tansa house? So we solve this problem temporarily by giving an artificial hostel number to Tansa house. But there has to be such mechanisms that have to be handled during the modeling itself, not subsequently after you have written problems. A row in a table represents information about one entity of a set or one object of a class. Entity set has an equivalent nomenclature in object-oriented modeling paradigm. In there, we call it a class, just as an entity set is equivalent to class, and number of entities similar in an entity set is as number of objects in a class. So this is nomenclature, otherwise conceptually it is same. Please note that no two rows are same in any table. This is absolutely an essential part of our model. We are guaranteeing that entity set represented as a table will never have two rows same. Why? Because each row has to have a primary key. In the worst case, the primary key will consist of all attributes taken together. And since primary key has to be unique, that means any two rows must differ in the value of at least one part of the primary key. So no two rows can be identical is guaranteed by this model. set of all rows represents the entity set depicted by the model, and it permits easy implementation as a sequential or indexed files. You would be familiar with sequential file or indexed files in the machine. So this is very easy to represent. The entity diagram is rectangle and associated ellipses. Entity set name, names of attributes is what you depict in that diagram. It must be accompanied by a detailed data dictionary. Now this is something that we often don't do, but in professional modeling this is required. So you think ER diagram means you draw a rectangle, ellipses, another rectangle, ellipses, that's over. No. Each such diagram should be accompanied by one or more pages of English description, which is called a data dictionary. Each entry in the data dictionary will represent, one, the entity set name and the some description about entity, and then for every attribute, attribute name, value representation, string, okay, numeric, whatever, typical values, permitted values, constraints. Constraints means the value cannot be beyond this or this, etc. Primary key attributes for entity set. All this must be documented, then and only then your entity model is considered complete. You agree with that? You will notice that none of us use this simple modeling in our conventional computational programs at all. But I hope you will appreciate why this is useful to validate whatever assumptions that you make. What is an ER diagram? This is the crux of the modeling. Now we are going closer to handling that multi-valued attribute. Each object in an entity set may have association with one or more objects in another entity set. For the first time, we are talking about two different entity sets being related with each other in some way or the other. One student takes several courses. One course is taken by several students. Agreed? If you observe, courses were appearing as a multi-valued attribute for student. Students were appearing as a multi-valued attribute on a course. The fact of life is, there is one course, there is one student, there are 300 courses, there are 4,500 students. Quite independent of these two pieces of information, there is an information about students taking courses. And we seem to be getting muddled up because this information is broken partly into the student entity attribute and partly into the course entity. What if we say this nonsense must stop? And I will represent the association of these two entity sets, where some student has taken some course is taken by some student, by a separate relationship or association. Then I can remove these multi-valued attributes from both these entities and create another representation. That representation is called a diamond. A diamond connecting two rectangles is used to show this association. What is the association? Consider this. This is the student set. This is the course set. There are 300 courses here, there are whatever, 4,500 students here. What is a registration form? A registration form is nothing but 9905794 3, saying I am registered for IT640, I am registered for CS101, I am registered for so-and-so. Okay. Each registration form, which on an average has 6 courses listed, actually represents 6 such lines. Some student has 2 lines, some students have 7 lines. Some courses have 300 lines, some courses have 10 lines. Each line at one end has a roll number, at the other end has a course code. So what is a line? It is an association between one student and one course. The total registration information is nothing but the collection of all such lines, where each line is identified by the two endpoints, the roll number on this side and the course code on this side. Would you agree that if I could represent all the lines as a set of lines, then I don't need those multi-valued attributes? Because once I have represented, and how many lines on an average will be there? We agreed, 4,500 students multiplied by 6, give or take a few depending upon the number. Those many lines, if I represent somehow, then I have captured all information. This association is represented by a diamond in our diagram. So I have student, I have course, and I have a diamond which is called a relationship set or an association set
This is relationship set is what gives the model the name ER model, entity relationship model. This is an entity, this is another entity. The relationship between these two entities is student registers for this course. Now here's the beauty. Student is an entity, so it has primary key and other attributes, all single valued now. Course is an entity, again it has primary key and attributes which are single value. Each entry in that table represents one entity of that set. This diamond represents what? This diamond really represents those association lines, as I said. Can I not treat these lines as entities of different kind? Each line is actually an association entity, a registered entity. If I treat this diamond to represent an entity set, then what would be the attributes of each individual entity inside that diamond? Each entity is a line, right? If I were to give attributes to this line as an entity, what are the attributes clearly observable? Roll number is one attribute. Course code is another attribute. Now I see that I have this registered for as a set. If I interpret this as a set, I don't have to create artificially attributes for it. I know that each entry into this registered for set, if I take it as a set, is uniquely defined by the corresponding primary key of the student and corresponding primary key of the course code. I don't require anything else. So each line is uniquely represented by the primary key of participating entities. But because I am treating this as an entity set, I have the possibility of having more attributes for this entity set. Can this entity set have any attributes which are other than student or course? Is there any feature which can be not associated only with student or only with course? Date of registration is one, but there is a far more important commodity all of you are concerned with it. The grade. Can a grade be the attribute of a student? No, student gets multiple grades different in different subjects. Can a grade be an attribute of a course? That would be very nice. You know, CS 634, A grade. So everybody gets A grade. That is not possible. The grade is an attribute of the association. A particular student doing A course gets some grade. Same student doing another course gets another grade. Some other student doing the same course gets another grade. So, effectively, the attribute grade is actually an attribute of this line. Each line has this attribute. Notice that in our ER model, there's no way for us to describe this grade as an attribute anywhere. It can't be put as an attribute of entity student, can't be put as an attribute of entity course, because it's an attribute of this. But this model permits us to say that this registered for, which is actually an association, treating this as if it is an equivalent of an entity set, where each entity is defined uniquely by S role and C code. You know what it means? I don't have to define a primary key for every row here, every line here. The primary key is automatically defined as a combination of S role and this. But I can define an additional attribute for this, which is grade, which was not possible to be accommodated anywhere else. And if I do this, then I can extend the implementation of the model in the same way to say that since this is an entity set, I will represent this also as a table. If I implement this as a table, let me first go to that table. S role, C code, grade. Maybe there is a course whose grades have been declared, he got AB. Maybe there is a course whose grades have not come, null. And how many entries in this table for this relationship I will have? 4,500 multiplied by on an average 6. It doesn't matter how many exact entries are. Please note two very important problems you have solved in one shot. One, we have gotten rid of multi-valued attributes. In fact, the moment you see a multi-valued attribute, you should see the potential for another entity somewhere, which needs to be modeled separately as an entity set, and then association has to be established. Sometimes you may have to do it artificially. More importantly, grade, which is an attribute which can only be associated with those relationship lines, can be modeled now. And now you will understand that if I have a database, in that database I design one table which is students table, another table which is course table, and a third table which is the reg table or registration table. I don't need to store anything else to get academic registration and grade information. Do you agree? This is actually called a schema for the database. A schema is a scheme of tables. Each table has some attributes and name. These three tables actually form a schema for academic office system, database scheme. Student table, course table, reg table. External interface may be different. If external interface and registration form comes, it is my job to ensure, first, check whether the student exists in the student table. Why? Because I should not permit any lallu to register for any course. That fellow must exist. You should have paid fees, whatever. Secondly, he should not be registering for a course which does not exist. So I should cross-check with my course table. Consequently, at the beginning of a semester, the activity that the academic office must do is update all the role table, the student table and course table to reflect up-to-date information. As a student registers, keep inserting data into this table and do nothing. Now, if a teacher wants to get all the students in my course, when I go to that interface and I click, actually, this data is being retrieved dynamically. So even if you register half a second earlier, I will get that. Similarly, if you ever retrieve your own registration data, it is never stored in a separate form. For your own registration data, the moment you put a roll number, only the courses for your roll number will be extracted and put in an interface to show. So even if you have updated your registration by changing a course, your faculty advisor looking at that data will get the latest update. And that is because you guarantee consistency of data no matter how it is seen by whom. Because you are storing only one unique thing. It is not dependent on multiple. This session has some more slides. I'll request you to keep looking at the posting on the CS634 course page. There will be a Moodle page that will be set up, as I said, by Friday. All the slides will be put up there. Do read the other slides which we have not discussed here and think about that. And do appreciate this. We'll, of course, then have some additional modeling exercise, etc. later. Thank you very much.